Alright, the title of this episode is going to be Esoterica for the Cabal, and today I'm not going to talk about Esoterica for the Cabal. I'm going to talk about Esoterica and Cabalism some other time. But the reason I named this video Esoterica for the Cabal, or I'm going to name this video, I'm speaking in the future as though it is the past. The reason I named this Esoterica for the Cabal is I'm not going to promote this video at all. I'm going to just upload it to the channel, and the people who this video is directed at are the people who I know are already paying that much attention to the channel. Therefore, this video is specifically for them. It's not necessarily that it's, you know, to be sealed and not for the eyes of the general public or anything like that, but specifically today I am going to be responding to two of the more active members of the institution of None and All right now. And so let's get right to that. All right, so we have a friend who is watching this these videos, and they're leaving some great responses and good thoughts, and we value those a great deal. so we just wanted to basically, there isn't very much to respond to there. There's a little bit. I'm gonna not do that today. I'm gonna do that another day. That's not what I'm gonna do with that person in particular. But I just wanted to say that this person has a grasp that the duality is a unity, and that they demonstrate that they understand the mystical mathematical equation that we have been producing, 0 + 1 = 2. It's the basic premise of all mystical insight, and it's also the actual natural way that the universe really works. And so when you realize that, you realize that the duality is not a blending, and that for the unity to be there and for the structural integrity of reality to be, you've got to have this polarizing, you know, you've got to have two completely seemingly opposite effects going on at the same time simultaneously. That's what creates, it's the distinctions that actually creates the structural integrity. It's the diversity. Right? Diversity is a good thing. Unfortunately, people want to monocrop everything and make the whole universe a one-size-fits-all. Bang! Nail. Nail. Love and light nail. We're just going to love and light nail this. Positive nail! You know what I'm saying? And I don't like nails. You know what I'm saying? I'm not into nails. You know what I'm saying? In general, I may be a nail myself, but the love and light nail is not going to work. I was going to say that light workers, you're off the hook today, but that's going to be my only jab at you. I'm going to take my issues up with you later. So yeah, one is always two. One is always two. So for everybody who's like one, you should be seeing 2 and 0, because really, it really is 0 and infinity. which infinity is just 2 zeros out of 1, and then when it turns to 1, the 0, 1, 0, 1, 0, 1. Okay, that's reality. The universe isn't constantly expanding, it's breathing. Okay, there is as much infinite space between 0 and 1 as there is between, you know, 1 and infinity. So that people, the positivist materialist worldview that has to be, you know, 100% all one size fits all, nail, love and light nail, not working. Anyways, thanks for realizing that, my friends, that the duality is a unity, that it's the diversity that we want to celebrate. It's the changes, it's the shift. You negative energy is creating space for you to grow and change. If you're not listening to what you perceive as the negative stuff in the world, the things you don't like, if you aren't willing to face the things that you don't like, you are not going to grow. Which, real quick, for those of you who might be here for the anthropology, this is a condition of anthropology. We should talk about this for the Esoterica Cabal of anthropology. If you're in the Anthro Cabal, this Esoterica is specifically for you. When we talk about evolution, it's not teleological, right? It doesn't go somewhere. It's not ever trying to reach some greater thing. So like, every time we use the word evolve as though that should put you in a greater, higher, more conscious, more enlightened, that it should be constantly better, more perfect, more perfected. Wrong. Evolution is not teleological. Evolution is actually regressive. It only exists in reverse, and it's really just a mark for the path that you left behind you as you moved forward through what you call your space-time continuum. And this is not for individuals, this is for groups. But the groups are made of individuals, and the reason that I don't know what intelligent design means to everybody else, but I know what it means to me. Animals, you know, are active participants in choosing things like migration routes and what to eat next, and where do we go find water. You can believe in instincts all you want, but animals are so much more like humans than most people want to admit. And the reality is that the intelligent design comes from within the organism. The organism actively participates in its evolution, and evolution is really a system of, it's an active system of adaptation to environmental pressure. So for the love and light nail, if you're going to just only focus on what you like, and you're going to absolutely dismiss anything that challenges you or that you don't like, you are not going to adapt, and you are not going to evolve, and chances are you're going to have to go extinct back into the ether. You're going to be translated for sure. You won't exist in this space-time continuum anymore, basically. And that's what a lot of them think that they're trying to do. They just don't understand what it really actually means. And such is the nature of death. People don't understand it. And they think that by misunderstanding death, they will grasp their lives more, whatever. This is like, hey, atheists, would I go to a guy who doesn't watch football, doesn't like football, doesn't play football, and doesn't even believe in football for information about football? Love and light now. Oh, sorry. All right, so the next thing is that response just took almost 9 minutes. That's terrible. I have an imbalance. This is a problem, people. Anyways, how to get to the bulk of this response in, a minute. What does church hopping do for individuals besides educating them? Let me rail that out for you real quick. You as an individual, by church hopping, are going to break your own love and light nail in half. You have opinions, whether you come from a religious background or you come from an anti-religious background or you come from a non-religious background, you have opinions about people. You have opinions about the way things are. You have opinions about what is happening inside these buildings, even though you've never been to them and you've never seen it. You have opinions about what you think you know about humanity, social situations, cultural integrity, and how it manifests in the world. You think that you know. Okay. And what this experience does for you as an individual is it breaks all that stuff in half. And the more you go to different places again and again and again, and what I'm trying to remember, I'm telling you, do not, if you go to one place, don't go there again until you've gone everywhere else. But what that's going to do is it's going to break your stereotypes in half. It's just going to snap them. That is an educating experience, and in a lot of ways, if you're asking why is education important, education is so important, but are we doing that in the world today? Is secular education working? I haven't seen where it is, but I haven't been to Europe, so this is the point. Henry Rollins says, on Big Think, if you want to make the world a better place, start with yourself and start by breaking your own boundaries. Go somewhere else. Well, we can't all afford trips to Europe, Henry Rollins. Thanks a lot. Fucking some of us, are on the I got $5 till Friday diet. You know what I'm saying? Like, so for us, every single one of these different, what I call them is Dharma gates, every single one of those Dharma gates is its own completely immersive cultural experience. It's tourism for free right here in your neighborhood, in your environment, wherever you are in the world, really. Visiting houses of religion is going to trip you out. It's going to be weird. It's going to be different. It's going to be difficult. It's going to be hard. A lot of times it just sucks. It just plain out sucks. Sitting through it sucks. And it's like working out. You know what I'm saying? It sucks. You hate it. But when you come out, it makes you feel great. And it puts you into this whole other experience of life that makes everything deeper and broader at the same time. Bing! Oh, deeper and broader at the same time? You mean you want us to embrace differing opinions in our minds simultaneously? We should link our left and our right brain together? Two? At the same time? Count to two? Oh my gosh. Crazy. Alright. So, I'm serious. It will do that. It's like a drug, also in a lot of ways. It's exhausting and it makes you high. And it's totally free and it's really it's a trip for you. Now, what does it do for the churches themselves? That is actually probably an entire video that is all on its own. But what I'm going to say, at least first of all, is that these places need Pied Pipers going in there. A lot of the criticisms that people have of churches around you, especially Christian churches in your area, no matter where you live, especially if you live in the United States, and if you live in Arizona, I guarantee you, the churches around you are prisons for kids. And they're horrible experiences for them. And so if you go in there and you have a twinkle in your eye and you look cool and you sit through their thing and you speak well and you are intriguing and you can't obviously freak out or do anything stupid because that's going to turn people off. But if you go in there and you play it cool and you stick to your truth and you let your Satragaha, your soul force shine through, you're gonna just unleash people from their cages. You're just gonna be, it's like handing out red pills, I guess. Is the red pill is the good one, the one that you want to take that unlocks you from the matrix? It does do that for people inside the churches. It also establishes eventually an interfaith practice pattern that I believe will save churches themselves. Churches are gonna have to realize that they cannot compete against each other, that they're going to have to cooperate with each other, and that they're going to have to sew together this superior network of goods and services that is more sustainable and more collectivist and not profit-driven and not beholden to, whoever's got the biggest military. And hey, time will tell if that cycle replays itself, but this was the idea 2,000 years ago and it worked for a long time, and it worked all the way up until, and then it still is working for people who have continued to ride the wave at the on the crest. And there's a lot of people left behind in the wake, you know, soggy and wet and sad that they aren't catching another ride. But that's what you do. You go in there. If you have anthropological qualifications to speak on religion and you've done it enough, you know what's working and you know what's not working. You've started to isolate these salient components that have value, and you can even present those to the clergy, which I have done, and they have listened to me. I'm a little more, let's just say, when I'm in front of a clergy member on Sunday, especially with a group and especially with a beard and some hair, my word carries a certain amount of authority with them, even if they have no clue who I am. And I've seen it happen. It's happened. It's been done. Okay? It's been done, and it will be done again. So what does it do for them? I've already changed several groups in my area that I've gone to just with my presence. So don't doubt what impact you can have. Now, do we preach none and all to them? Do we convert them? Do we hold them hostage? And how does all of this expand our influence as the institution of none and all? Those are actually not, especially, for example, the hostage situation thing. This is a militant pacifist group. We are nonviolent. We have a single prohibition. It's don't cross the line in the sand, which means no uniforms, no guns, no bombs. Like, if you're part of any kind of military unit, you're going to need to quit before you can fully embrace the privileges and benefits of being part of this organization. You're going to need to quit and repent, because you know, there's a karmic debt to be paid for everybody who ever crosses that line. So we absolutely never advocate for that sort of thing. I understand that was a joke, but it's something that should be taken seriously. Now, do we preach none and all to them? Yes and no, mostly no. First of all, when you're going church hopping, it should be an anthropological field immersion experience. So, you know, get some experience with what that means, but basically it means that you're there to quietly observe and not interrupt. You're not there to change them. You're there to change yourself. You're there to learn. You're there to record data. You're there to observe. You're there to be a fly on the wall. You're there to be a silent force. In a lot of ways, it's a great opportunity for you to go and just practice your own meditation, because they're going to be spewing a lot of times this banal horror show of bullshit, and you don't even want to listen to it. Their music sucks. The message sucks. The people themselves might be real nice, and they might be just regular people, and that's going to kind of trip you up a little bit. You're like, why would these regular people continue to pay homage to this banal, you know, the music sucks, the message sucks, etc. And there, that is an interesting rabbit hole of analyzation that, you know, we could go into that at some point. There's all kinds of data on that, by the way. Anthropologists have been really, 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 really curious about the question of why people stick with cultural adaptations, which seem to be, you know, they're not favorable. But no, we don't go there to change them or preach to them or convert them. Now, what happens is that, generally speaking, and it depends on where you go, there are places where you go and this doesn't happen. And I'll tell you, this isn't always true, because I have done, sometimes I do pull stunts out to try to, like, put shift onto people. And that's varying with how much respect that I have for the organization and what they're doing. But no, for the most part, you're just there to be there and to absorb. Like I was saying, what will happen is, in most places, certainly not some places, for example, Mormons and Catholics, it doesn't happen in Catholic churches, because in Catholic church, no one knows if you're Catholic or not. There's no, hey, this guy's not Catholic button that goes off in everybody's mind when you walk through the door. nobody bothers you in a Catholic church, and nobody comes up and talks to you. You don't get any FaceTime with anyone really, other than the like little peace be with you thing. So no, in certain places this doesn't happen. Mormonism, for example, as soon as you go into a Mormon church, if you know you're not part of their group, they all know it. All eyes on you. Everybody wants to know who you are, why you're there, and you know what they can do to get you to stay. So it's very uncomfortable, and it's weird, and it's a psychoanalysis of yourself. It's like, why is this making me? All these people want to do is ask me very normal, basic questions that, you know, if I was at a job interview, I wouldn't have a problem answering questions like, who are you? What's your name? Where are you from? Why are you here? So, you know, that's what I'm saying, is a lot of these places, people are going to come up to you, they're going to swarm you, they're going to get all over you, and they're going to be like, ah, oh, we are lumbies, let us eat your brain. And then you give them your brain, and they're like, wait, this brain is creating thoughts. Must not have thoughts. Oh my goodness, going home, thinking about women's rights and civil liberties and reading the Gospels, and like, you know, all of a sudden people are, bam, liberating themselves. And you never know if it's because of the conversation that they had with you that one time when you went in through the door. All right, so do we preach? Do we convert? It happens, but as a general practice, no. How does doing all this expand the Institution of None and All's influence? You tell me. You want to expand the Institution of None and All's influence? Tell a friend, come back tomorrow. See you later.